my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be always pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Take a seat, please. Not sure if you remember, a little while ago, we did a survey program, and I asked a number of you if you'd be able to do it, called NCD, the Natural Church Development. And it came back with a number of responses for our community. And one of the ones, and it splits it up into 8 different categories, and if all of these are healthy, it's a sign of this being a healthy church. And traditionally, Anglican churches everyone has a lowest, and the tradition in Anglican churches, the lowest category is what is described as passionate spirituality. And one of the reasons for that, I suspect, is that we think of spirituality often as being, the hands in the air stuff, and we wave our hands and we clap, and it's a very emotional place. That's how we often think of spirituality, as being connected with our emotions. And there's a certain yes, but in that. It is important that we give ourselves, and that is including our emotional selves, to our relationship with God. But there's more to it than that. And in 1 John, I feel like we have the writings of a person who has this deep, passionate spirituality, and they're trying to get the message across. And like so many of our conversations, it feels like these words that I'm saying just aren't quite connecting to the reality of my experience. Teenagers, when they fall in love and they try and describe it, and I don't know if you did this, I wrote some terrible poetry as a teenager. I don't know, did you ever do that? Yeah? Mm-hmm. You'll go back and look at it. It's like, oh, that was terrible. But it's kind of the struggling with words to put our feelings, and when you're a teenager, it's angst and love and romance and those sort of things. So the writer here, he's trying to get this idea across about the nature of God. And it's a really remarkable idea for its day, because the picture in the world of its day of God or gods, because many of the people back then had gods, was that it was about power. It was about these normal powers, but made bigger. Yeah. So in this day and age, it's the equivalent of your superheroes, isn't it? People are strong, so Superman is the strongest. Detectives are smart, Batman is the greatest detective. This is how superheroes work. That's how the gods back then worked. And if you were a monotheist, believed in one god, well, that must be the strongest possible, the smartest possible. And the writer of John is going, I've got a different idea. I've got a different idea. It's the idea that God isn't even the most loving, but that God is love. And you can see I'm just trying to tell you what this means. Like this experience that I have of God is love. Now when it comes to love, in English, when we talk about love, quite often we're talking about that sort of that emotional stuff, aren't we? Your first girlfriend, oh. Mills and Boone and the old bodice rippers, yeah. I mean, look, I don't have a problem with that. I mean, I'm not a Mills and Boone person myself. I'm more of a sci-fi fantasy kind of guy. But that's romance and the flush of hormones and the idea of love. But real love, the love that is God, isn't about pursuing your romantic interests. It isn't about having a chiseled jawline and any of those other things. It's this, it's the power to transform by emptying ourselves and by God, emptying God's self out so that others may be transformed and made better. I remember talking to a kid at school, and she was saying that she had a partner. I can't remember if it was a girlfriend or a boyfriend. I think she said girlfriend in the hope that it would shock me. You know, it's like, move on. and my question was, is it a good relationship? How do you know it's a good relationship? Well, you make your partner better and your partner makes you better. You give of yourself to your partner that they might be better, and they give of themselves to you that you might be better. That's so in relationships. However, it's not just about your husband or your wife or someone in your family. It goes beyond that. It goes beyond that, you know, these people who are close to us. It goes to the people maybe that we bump into in the street. It goes to the people that we see in the shops. It goes to the people we might never meet. That we care for them, that we are willing to empty ourselves out for them, because we know that first God emptied God's self out for us. Jesus comes at this from a different perspective. Jesus uses a more agrarian metaphor, talking about vines and branches and things like that. Now, if you ever go across from Morning Tea or you go to Solomon's, you'll see over the fence there is a passion fruit vine that is quite substantial. Every year I have to use the hedge trimmer just to hack it back so it doesn't just take over the sheds. Gets a lot of good water and sun and soil. And Jesus talks about the vine and the branches in the vine. Now here's the thing. A passion fruit or a grapevine is made up of intertwining small branches. I am the vine, you are the branches, says Jesus. And this is community coming together, where the barrier between us and God starts to dissolve. Because God is with us for us, and we are with God for God. This is spirituality. And yes, sometimes our words start to break down. But if you want another point of access into it, think about this. In a place in the service in the not too distant future, we will share with each other the greeting of peace. We will say, peace be with you, and somebody else will say, peace be with you back to us. We will say to each other, what I want for you is peace, so that you might grow. What I wish for you is space, so that you might experience the grace of God, so the brokenness in you might heal. And I will work to create a space where that might be. And then just after, we're going to come up and we're going to share bread and wine as Jesus did with his disciples. Because Jesus says, what I wish for you is sustenance for the soul, sustenance for your spirit, that you might grow. And then we take that experience out into the world where we've had a space to heal and mend and grow and be fed. Understanding that we then share that gift with the world. Because you can tell a passion fruit vine not by the leaves or the branches or the soil, but by the fruit. And the fruit of God are acts of love. Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.